Belinda presents this unabridged recording of British Politics, A Beginner's Guide, written by Richard S. Grayson and read by David Thorn. One. Introduction. In May 2010, most people expected that the era of New Labour would draw to a close, but nobody expected it to end in the way that it did. What the opinion polls had been saying for some time before the election was that a Conservative majority was the likely result, although perhaps only a narrow one. Not a single one of the experts predicted that the outcome would be the spectacle of David Cameron and Nick Clegg holding a joint press conference announcing a liberal conservative, David Cameron's words, coalition. It was a breathtaking sight. The Times, on its front page on 13 May, dubbed it a very British revolution, and the Daily Mail saw it as the great number 10 love-in. On the day that the deal was announced, BBC political editor Nick Robinson said that he had been using so many different superlatives over the days in which the negotiations had taken place that he had now run out of any that were suitable to describe the final agreement. That a coalition has been formed does indeed appear to be revolutionary. No such arrangement has been reached in the UK since 1940. Not since 1945, when the wartime coalition ended, has a Liberal sat in the cabinet. The UK's electoral system is stacked very much in favour of one party having an overall majority, and the hung parliament, which led to a coalition, has only once occurred in the memory of most people, 1974, when a coalition was not the result. Most remarkable of all is that the Liberal Democrats sit in coalition with the Conservatives. Such a deal sticks in the throats of many members of both parties due to their long-standing ideological hostility to each other. From the first day of the deal, there were signs that some members would give up politics or go elsewhere. Where is this coalition likely to lead? Why is it described as a revolution? And is it really? What does it mean for the future of British politics? This audiobook addresses all these questions, but also tries to explain some deeper and long-running issues in British politics. It also sets out how British politics and government work, to give some idea of how the policies put forward by the coalition will be implemented. It starts from the belief that there is a huge gap between the public and politicians. This audiobook tries to explain why that gap is so large and tries to remove some of the mystery of politics in an effort to reduce it. In so doing, it aims to help listeners make some sense of the often confusing rituals of Parliament and to tackle the growing sense that many people have of politics being pointless. It is written partly from the perspective of someone who has worked full-time in national politics and stood for Parliament in 2005 and 2010 for the Liberal Democrats in Hemel Hempstead, as part of an involvement in politics stretching back to the 1980s. But the author has also stood back from the day-to-day process of politics as a university lecturer teaching about British politics. That has provided plenty of time in which to reflect on why, for so many people, British politics is so mystifying, frustrating, and often just downright annoying. One of the overriding beliefs which the author brings to this audiobook is a belief that society produces its politicians. That partly means that if a society is obsessed with celebrities, then politicians will put themselves forward as personalities. The most mundane aspects of their daily lives become public property, because that is what the public is interested in. The media tells us so much about the wives of party leaders because the public is genuinely interested in them, just as much as, or more so, than it has an interest in party policy. We saw much of that during the 2010 campaign, and for all that, Nick Clegg very effectively argued for his party's policies in that election campaign, the Clegg mania, which followed the leaders' debates on TV, can partly be understood in the context of a celebrity-obsessed culture. Society's influence on politics is not seen only in the froth of election coverage. It is also seen in the limits on politicians' actions. For example, there are regularly local public campaigns against politicians apparently callously wanting to close local schools. But more often than not, these decisions are not driven by what politicians want or do not want to do. Rather, they are driven by population factors, such as birth rates. In the 1980s, schools which had flourished as the baby boomers went through school in the 1950s and 1960s became unsustainable due to there being fewer children. The Conservatives took much flak for school closures, but they were largely beyond the control of government. The vast range of social changes which have taken place in Britain in recent decades are well beyond the scope of this audiobook. But they need to be stated at the outset as huge constraints on what politicians can achieve. One central question runs through this audiobook. Why should we care about British politics? That is a question which is increasingly on the minds of a public which tends to assume some or all of the following. It makes little difference which party is in power because they are all generally the same. Politicians promise much, but deliver little, and sometimes know that they can deliver little, even when they make promises. Politicians generally serve their own interests, and/or the interests of a small group of people, which might be, for example, their party, a business, a profession, or a union. Related to that broad "why should we care?" question, several other pressing contemporary issues are addressed. Is British politics in crisis? That question is crucial, given steadily declining voter turnouts, which was only reversed in 2010, matched by rising public cynicism about politics and politicians. At the same time, political parties find it increasingly hard to recruit members and activists. That is not necessarily because people are any less political, but because they choose to direct their political activities into single-issue campaigns and pressure groups. If that trend continues, can the current structures maintain themselves? In short, will there be anyone left to govern? What is Britain's place in the world? Britain's proud or shameful, depending on your perspective, imperial past has left Britain with a sense of being a world player. Yet it is now not even entirely sovereign over its own affairs, due to membership of the European Union, let alone the affairs of others. How influential is Britain now, and how do other countries influence us? Have all political parties become too similar? Parties are often the most mysterious part of the political process. This audiobook addresses what really makes them tick and how people get involved, examining whether we really need parties. Who has real power in politics? Throughout the audiobook, the roles of different government institutions and the power of personalities are considered. Who really is making the decisions? As a background to that, the influence of the media, sometimes difficult to quantify, is assessed. Does British politics work? There are two aspects to this subject. First, the audiobook explores the mechanisms of politics so that listeners can gain a better understanding of how the institutions of the state have evolved. For example, how does a policy contained in an election manifesto become enacted as law? Second, it considers whether these processes actually do a good job. As we will see, the answer to the question of whether the system works depends on your values and what you want to achieve. Are we at the end of the new labor era? This question may seem rather odd. After all, in the 2010 election, Labour lost and was thus ejected from office. However, this only happened after the Conservative Party had changed, or appeared to change, significantly. So a key theme of the audiobook is to explore how far New Labour in office between 1997 and 2010 created a new political consensus, into which the Conservatives had to move before they could be elected, even in partnership. The author hopes that anyone listening to this book might get to its end and be at least a little less cynical about the political process. The general argument is that most politicians genuinely do have ideals, and that they set out on a political career with the best intentions. Moreover, it is argued that political parties have, at times, though not always, made a significant impact on the direction of government policy in ways that have affected the lives of everyone in the country. Above all, the author hopes that people who listen to this book might realize that they can make a difference if they get involved in politics and will choose to do so. 2. Events, dear boy, events. A brief history of British domestic politics since 1945. Today's British politics begins in 1945. Although that may seem long past, we are still living with the legacy of the kind of welfare state set up by the Labour government of 1945 to 51. Its institutions and systems are fundamentally still in operation today. Ever since then, politicians have been trying to make them work, not least because the National Health Service remains dear to the hearts of the British people. The other reason for taking 1945 as a starting point is that the characters and events of the years since then are central to the intellectual hinterland of most of those journalists and academics who comment on politics today. There is a great propensity in Britain to look at the past as a guide to the future, and much political comment is littered with comments about how Attlee handled his cabinet, or how Callaghan tried to deal with the unions. So it is essential to have some idea of the history if one is to understand the comparisons that are drawn between it and politics today. This chapter includes some of the unexpected events which caused problems for governments and which led Harold Macmillan to say, "Events, dear boy, events," when asked by a journalist about the most challenging problems facing governments. Although policies do play a part in the chapter, it is not policy-focused. Rather, policy is used to illustrate general points about the nature of governments, with details being left for the chapter devoted to policy. 1945 to 51. Creating the modern welfare state. The welfare state was not suddenly established in 1945. Even prior to the First World War, the Liberal Party had laid the foundations of the welfare system with provision for some pensions and unemployment benefits. This system had been steadily developed in the interwar years, with all parties playing a role. Neville Chamberlain, as Health Minister, was especially active in expanding healthcare provision. By 1939, Britain had one of the world's more developed welfare systems. However, the Second World War brought about a revolution in the way people thought about welfare provision. This was partly due to the practical demands of war. The Luftwaffe's bombs paid no attention to the ability of their victims to pay for hospital treatment, and the emergency hospital scheme was established at the outbreak of war to provide free treatment for the civilian wounded. Meanwhile, The Emergency Medical Service coordinated the work of previously disparate hospitals. Such measures can be seen as the basis of the National Health Service, in that they proved that such coordination was possible. Aside from practical developments, there was also an ideological shift in 1939-45. As Paul Addison's classic book, The Road to 1945, sets out, the shared experience of war encouraged people to embrace collective ways of tackling shared problems. This had an impact on government at the highest levels. As early as 1940, government decided that it was not only necessary, but desirable to tackle the problems the country faced in a collective manner, not only during the war, but after it. Its War Aims Committee agreed in August 1940 that it would consider means of perpetuating the national unity achieved in this country during the war through a social and economic structure designed to secure equality of opportunity and service among all classes of the community. This was exceptionally radical language for 1940 and committed the government to pursuing the kind of agenda which both Labour and the Liberals, but not the Conservatives, had favoured prior to the war. A result of this aim was the publication of the Report of the Interdepartmental Committee on Social Insurance and Allied Services in late 1942, known for short as the Beveridge Report, after its chairman.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.